welcome everyone this evening. If you'll stand, grab your hymnal, page 413, sing the first and last verse. Bring them in. I knew y'all didn't grab them books. That's fine, I was way behind. All right, we can go ahead and start. I said, how does it start? And so I was trying to hear her the whole time. And so, but y'all did a great job carrying me through. And so join us in prayer this morning, or this evening. Dear Holy Father, Lord, we thank you so much for all that you have done for us, Lord, and given us the opportunity to gather together again. Lord, we ask, we know there's so many reasons that we can stay home. There's so many reasons we cannot come together, Lord. But we ask that you would just allow us not to take advantage of those, Lord, but more of the opportunity to get to come together and to serve you. We know it's not the building. We know it's not the place where we meet, Lord, but we know the importance is in the gathering of fellow believers, Lord. We ask that you would just continue to bless this evening, Lord, and bless this service, Lord, that we could just get something out of your word. For it's in your name we pray. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Oh, I thought there were books on the set. A couple things. Obviously, we're not having vacation Bible school because it would be going on as we speak. And so that is just, we've postponed it a couple of times, and then with everything going on, it's just, we felt it was just best to cancel it for this summer, which this is the only summer I can ever remember us not having a vacation Bible school in several years. But be in prayer that obviously we don't get to minister to the children that are in our community. And so, but God would just make that happen in other ways and give our church other opportunities in the way to do it. But continue to be in prayer for that. And then also our teen and junior camp is next week. So it's July 20th through the 24th. And they will be here at 10 a.m. And then it's going to be different days as far as I know Friday they're going to Six Flags. And then they have different activities. But it's going to be 10 a.m. and but it will end that evening. Is there going to be a schedule?
There will be a meeting at 5:15 Sunday night.
Yes, 5:15 Sunday night. So any of the teens.
I need a parent and the camper. No matter if you're a teen or a junior, I need a parent for each one because it's so different this year.
Yes, it is very, very different. But if you have, I was texting all the teens this week or today about coming. But if you know one that's not here that may have not heard about it, please let them know so that they can come. I promise they'll have a great time. There's a lot of things that we're going to do throughout the week as far as just we'll have our speakers from camp. We'll still have our God and I time, things like that. We'll still have games. And then Friday we're going to Six Flags. And like I told the teens today, make sure that you tell them, you can't just show up Friday to go to Six Flags. And so you got to be here throughout the week. And then Six Flags is at the end. But I promise every day is going to be a blast. There's a lot of things they get to do. And it gets them out of the house because they've been cooped up a lot.
And we can do some volunteers from the morning session till noon.
Yes. And so if you are able to do that and you can volunteer, we are more than happy to have you come help out. And for whatever reason, just show up. And I promise we'll give you something to do. And then our fundraiser for our team, for our juniors, is the T-shirts. If you would like to order some, just see one of our juniors. They have a list. They have a list that they can put you on, as far as what size you'd like to order. There's a few different colors. Are these two colors?
Green is definitely the color. The orange is not.
So green is one. Yeah, green, navy, and charcoal. The orange is not one. If you really want that, we can auction it off and see how much we can get out of just that one orange one. But if you would like to help out with the juniors, please do that. And just as far as the fundraiser goes. And then our yard sale will be August 1st. If you have something that you would like to put in that, just start getting it ready. Don't drop it off just yet. We'll let you know kind of when we can start taking that stuff. And Miss Ashley is heading that up. So if you have a question about it, she can help out. But also, if you have a camper, please be ready to help. And that's my least favorite one because it's so early. But it's all they have. We do have a good time, but it is a lot of work, and Ashley puts a ton of work into it. And so we definitely appreciate her doing that. Anything else that I've missed? All right, if you will stand, grab your hymnals, turn to page 332. See the first thing and last verse of Trust and Obey.
Thank you, Brother Christopher, for doing that. I really appreciate you leading the music. I don't tell you often enough, but I appreciate how you've led it over the last several years, and we're grateful to have you. All right, this is our prayer, and actually, Paula, don't hit that yet. I'm sorry. I told you to. I know. Just there you go. Just hit pause, and then we'll hit play here in a minute. Wait till after we're done with the prayer request. Are you going back to the back? Okay, we can have Hannah handle that for us. This is our time of prayer request and praise the Lord's. And I usually would let Christopher go ahead and do this, but I had a list and I wasn't sure he could read my handwriting. And so I thought I would do that. I don't know how many of you remember a young man that came with Timothy a few years back. He played the harp up here. Came a couple of times. He was Timothy's friend from Broadmoor Baptist. His name was Brookbody. Just a wonderful Christian, wonderful young man. He passed away this morning due to some weird that we have no idea exactly what it was. He's had some medical complications before, this one we really don't know what happened. But he passed away this morning. Pray for Timothy as well. He's pretty distraught about it. This was a very close friend of his. Pray for the entire Broadmoor Baptist Church body. That was an unexpected thing they weren't expecting. And this is a man that everybody in the church knew. He played the big pipe organ for them for years. Just an incredible musician. And now he's up in heaven playing for Jesus. If you would remember the Brook Body family and the Broadmoor Baptist Church family, that would be great. Also pray for Miss Carol Jaggers. You know, Miss Carol, this is John Lafitte's girlfriend. She fell off of the back of John's truck in the last day or two and pulled a, is there a meniscus? Is that what it is? In her leg, meniscus tendon? Yeah. Anyway, one of those things. I don't always get it, but it's in her knee. Would you pray for her? She may have to have surgery. The doctor's going to check it all out and everything, but pray for her as she heals. Continue to pray for Jan Montgomery as she continues to heal. Also want to lift up to you Miss Mary Ann's dad. He's had some health issues recently, so continue to remember him. She said yesterday that he was getting better, which we're excited to hear about. And I believe last time Reagan was telling us about Kelly Williams and that he needed some prayers. I'm not sure if he had to go for a checkup or whatever, but continue to lift them up. Also lift up Miss Deborah and Miss Raylan. They are both sick and not feeling well, so put them on your prayer list. Put on their the Catherine Bean family. She sent me a text this week saying that her family was better, but just to continue to remember them in prayer. Also Samuel and Charlie. Keep lifting up those two boys in our church for some things that they have. Continue to lift up Miss Bridget Brown for continued healing there. Miss Rose, pray for her family and her son specifically. Brother Billy always asks prayer requests for Miss Barbara Stevens. And I have an unspoken prayer request I want you to put on there for me. And then I have a praise the Lord here to share. Brother Dwayne tested negative on his last one. So he's now we're again corona free for however long, I don't know, but at least right now it is, and we're going to praise the Lord for that. So just continue to remember all of those, and I'm sure there's still a few that I've left off. But do you have a prayer request or a praise the Lord you'd like to share? Yes. Brittany Spence has it. She's still testing negative. She has it, so she's testing positive. Okay. Yes. Yep. Amen. Brother John and Brother James always jumping in on those vehicles, aren't they? Praise the Lord for them. Amen. Anybody else? Praise the Lord. Prayer request. Yes, Brother Paul. Okay. Unspokens, you have six. Pray for Miss Arlene. Yeah. Okay, pray for her. Pray for Miss Arlene and her oxygen. Okay. Anybody else? Yes, ma'am. Praise the Lord. I didn't realize she was that. Pray for the Corey family, specifically Alicia. Something miraculous to happen. Absolutely. Amen. Okay. Yes, ma'am. Uh-huh. Okay. Right. Praise the Lord. So put Daryl Procell on the prayer list. He's going in for cancer surgery in the morning. Okay. Absolutely. Lift him up. Yes. Awesome. Right. Right. She was under the car. Oh, wow. Well, praise the Lord, you found her. She's your partner in crime, huh? That's right. Anybody else? Yes, sir. Oh, I'm sorry, what? Tammy. Okay, Baxter, okay. Go ahead, Brother Philip. Okay. Right. And this is the guy with the lupus and the... No. Who was this? There was a Steve that had lupus and surgery this last week. Was that yours? Okay, go ahead. I'm sorry. Okay. And Steve, what's his last name? Huh? Skeevers, okay. The other one is Steve Sanders. We need to keep praying for him, okay? All right. Anybody else? I'm sorry, I got those confused. Yes, ma'am. Yep. Traveling Mercies. Traveling Mercies for their girls headed to California. Absolutely. Okay. Anybody else? Yes, ma'am. Okay, we like those. How's your son doing first? Amen. Right, just limping around a little bit, probably. Okay. Okay. Amen. Amen. Those are praise the Lord's. Just go back to work. Right. She is doing a little bit better. The spider bite is healing on Linda. Okay.
She still needs prayer.
Still needs prayer for her. Absolutely. Linda L.
Hale.
Hale. Okay. Two down, one to go. Absolutely. All right. Praise the Lord or prayer request. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Hey, we can keep praising that one for a long time. Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Yes, sir. Yes. Oh, okay. That's right. That's right. Well, pray that people get back to work and start buying cars again, right? That's right, we do. Amen. Yes, ma'am?
Just pray for all the parents having to make the decisions about school.
Yes.
I have no idea what we're going to do yet. And all the teachers just going back.
I'm not sure the schools know exactly what they're going to be doing just yet. Or at least, I mean, they've told the teachers to start preparing. I'm sure Miss Hannah was telling me she was getting back to doing some preparation. So I know they're preparing and getting planned to go back, but they may get to the week before and say, okay, time out, we're waiting 2 more weeks or we're waiting whatever. So pray for all of our, all of those to make those decisions on this, at the school administrators and stuff. All right? As well as parents making the choices to get their kids back in school too. So, all right? Anybody else? Yes'm? Travel mercies for Dennis, Josh, and who?
Amanda with her two kids.
And Amanda, okay, Bruner. Yeah. And they're going where? Galveston?
She is, yeah.
Okay, she's going to Galveston, yeah. Okay. Absolutely, absolutely. All right. What you need, Miss Rose? Okay. Anybody else? Praise the Lord or prayer request? Yes, sir. Okay. Okay, yes, because they work at the hospital, yes. Absolutely, because they're in the NICU unit, right, with the babies? That's right. So pray for all of those who have to work with patients who have respiratory problems every day. Absolutely. Pray for all of our health workers right now who are dealing with it. So, okay. Anybody else? Praise the Lord or prayer request? Miss Rose, I put your family and your son on there earlier. Anybody else? Okay, baby. Continue to put her mom on there. And put Miss Rose on there. Okay? Anybody else? All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, God, oh Lord, first of all, we just want to thank you and praise you for who you are and what you mean and what you do for us, and give you all the praise and the adoration and the glory that you deserve for just blessing us with life and blessing us with this planet that we can live on and that we can serve you on. And Lord, we just thank you for meeting our needs. Lord, a lot of times we forget to thank you for just the basic needs, food, water, air, gravity, things along that nature. And Lord, we don't want to take those for granted. We want to praise you for them and thank you for them, because you are the creator of life and you're deserving of our praise. And Lord, we just, when we come to you, it just seems like we ask and we ask and we ask and we ask. And Lord, sometimes we forget to praise you, but Lord, tonight there were a lot of praise requests, a lot of praises here tonight on thankfulness, the way you answered prayer. And Lord, you deserve that praise. And Lord, we don't ever want to forget to praise you and thank you for meeting those needs and for answering our prayers, Lord, according to your will. And God, we do come to you tonight as a needy people, as always. Lord, we as a church, we're needy right now. We need you, and we need you to protect us and to provide that protection, not just from this virus and other things, but Lord, protect us from ourselves, that we would live and that we would serve you the way your word teaches us to do that. Lord, help us to be a church who's out here witnessing for you daily and telling people about the Lord Jesus Christ and how he can save them from their sins. And Lord, that's the job that you've given us to do 24/7, 365 days a year, to spread your gospel throughout this entire world. Help us to do that and not forget what our job is. Lord, to learn and to grow in you. And we thank you for this church body that you've brought together, that we can come and we can grow and we can learn. And Lord, we can unite as a body to love on one another and care for one another, but also make sure that that gospel gets spread. And Lord, we pray for our missionaries that we've sent out from here, Lord, that you would give them peace and Lord, give them discernment as to how to proceed in the countries. Lord, a lot of them right now can't even receive mail, and they're dealing with a lot of even stricter restrictions than what we have. And God, I pray that you would just be with them and that you would strengthen them and encourage them. And Lord, I pray that you'd even be with the Denman family. Brother Denman lost his wife here in the last couple of weeks. And I pray that you would just give him strength and courage as he continues to deal with gospel radio, Latin America, all over the world. And Lord, that that gospel ministry would continue to get presented. Lord, we just thank you and we praise you for our missionaries. We ask that you continue to be with them. Lord, be with the leaders of our country. God, as they make decisions in regard to us, Lord, that they would not be politically motivated, that they would be people motivated, that they would care about the citizens of this country and do what's right, do what's best, Lord, according to your word, that they would follow your word and that they would seek you in every decision that they make, what's best for us spiritually, Lord, not necessarily what's best for us physically. And Lord, we also pray for many of these prayer requests that were brought up tonight. Lord, you know each and every single one of them, those that are need healing, those that are hurting, those who are sick, Lord, that need a touch from you. And Lord, we just continue to lift those up, especially our own folks, that you would protect them from this virus and continue those negative test results coming in. And Lord, we know that not everybody's as fortunate, but Lord, we pray for those who are dealing with it. We pray for those outside of our church who have this disease and who have this virus, and Lord, that they would heal from it quickly. Lord, we just ask that you would be with those who are going to be traveling over the next few days, some of them to California and Galveston and just all over, Lord. Our roads are very dangerous, people, with the way people drive today, and I pray that you would just protect our folks and keep a hedge of protection about them as they travel. Lord, we pray for many who are dealing with cancer, many who are dealing with hospice, and families who are going through some of those things, some of them, Lord, that just not sure exactly what's going to happen over these next few weeks. Lord, we lift up to you the Brook Body family, Lord, the Broadmoor Baptist Church family, Lord, and their tremendous loss that they dealt with the news that they dealt with this morning. Lord, I pray that you comfort and encourage that church body. And Lord, we know what it's like to lose a loved one, and but Lord, especially pray for them and pray for Brooke's family, and be a blessing to them. Be with Timothy, Lord. I know it was a really close friend of his, and I know he's taking it pretty hard, and I pray that you would just continue to be with all of us, Lord. There were many unspoken prayer requests that were mentioned here tonight, God. We just lift those up to you. You know what they are, and you know what each and every one of them are. And Lord, we pray for you to answer all of these requests, and what's according to your will. And Lord, we know that what's according to your will is for you to receive glory. We know that it's for people to be saved. And Lord, we also know that according to your will is what's best for us. And Lord, that's how we're asking you to answer all of these prayer requests and to bring them before you. God, we just love you and we thank you for all that you do for us. We ask that right now that you would be with us as we open up a portion of your scripture tonight, as we learn from it tonight. Lord, help us to soak it in, and Lord, and to apply it to our life, not just to hear it, but to learn it and to apply it and to live it, Lord. That's what it's all about, so that other people could come to know you as well. Thank you for these things. In the precious name of Jesus, we ask each and every one of them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Let's take our Bibles tonight. Let's turn over to the book of 2 John. You say, what chapter? There's only one. There's only one chapter with only a few verses in it. But so far, even though we've only been a couple of weeks into it, now, Miss Hannah, if somebody push that play button, thank you very much. We appreciate that. Even though it's only been just a few verses, we've already learned quite a bit just from this very short letter. Last week, we were in verses 4 through 6, and we saw where John began explaining his primary reason and purpose for writing this short letter to either a specific Christian lady or to a specific church that he had started himself. Elect lady could mean either one of those. First, we saw where he had rejoiced over their spiritual parenting, teaching their children to walk in the truth. John had not just heard that they were walking in the truth. He had seen it with his own eyes. And what a blessing it was to see the children of God walking in the truth. They were living by the principles of the truth which they had been taught. And listen, though I didn't mention it last week, children or students, either way you want to look at it, respond more to action than they do to instruction. All right? When they see their spiritual parents or their spiritual instructors walking in the truth or living out the truths that they're being taught. And notice an observable and positive difference in their lives as compared to the world's lives, most of the time they too will not just listen to the truth, but they too will also walk in the truth because of what they see in their spiritual instructors' lives. We can teach the truth of God's word to spiritual children all day long, but if we're not walking in that truth or living what we're teaching, then we're wasting our time and we're wasting theirs. It's just that simple. We're teaching the truth, but we're living a lie. Okay? And our physical children and our spiritual children, or those that we are supposedly instructing, see that. And they're not going to live by what they're taught. They're going to live by what they see in our actions and in our life. But John rejoices here because this specific lady or this specific church was doing a great job of not only teaching the church, but also teaching them how to walk and live in the truth, and they were doing so. We then saw John's request for them to keep doing what they were doing. And what they were doing was they were loving one another by teaching one another these truths. When we teach the truth and live by the truth, we prove to God's children that we love them. We prove to our children. Listen, you prove to your children every time you open up God's word and teach out of God's word, you teach your children out of God's word, you prove how much you love them when you do that. But you also do that when you instruct in God's word in the church. John didn't have to command them to love the brethren. They were already doing that. It was simply an encouragement for them to keep doing what they had been doing. And beginning in verse 7 here, we see why he encourages them to keep doing what they've been doing. He says in verse 7, "For many deceivers are entered into the world who confess not that Jesus is Christ, or that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh." This is a deceiver and an antichrist. Okay? Here we see John's warning here. Now, I know we recently talked about this antichrist or the spirit of antichrist back in 1 John. Okay? But let me give you a refresher course by briefly explaining what John is talking about. Of course, we know that the antichrist will eventually come and he will deceive a lot of people, and that's speaking about a specific person. But it also speaks about a spirit of anti-Christianity in the world. It was prevalent in John's day, and guess what? It's prevalent today. We see it all around us. The Greek word for antichrist here means an opponent of Christ. The prefix anti means against or opposed to, but it can also mean instead of or an imitation of. We know that Jesus Christ is the truth, correct? Everybody say amen to that. Amen. He is the truth. He said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me." We know that he's the truth. Well, what is against or is an opponent of truth? What is it? What's an opponent of truth? A lie. It's the exact opposite of it, right? Lying and deceitfulness are opponents or anti-truth. So if someone is an opponent of the truth, they are a deceiver and the liar, right? That's what I get when I read it. John only encourages or continues to encourage and remind them to keep loving one another by teaching and walking the truth, but he also continually warns the elect lady here of deceivers and liars, because they're all over. They're all over. These are anti-Christians or opponents of Christ who will do anything in their power to destroy him, to destroy his gospel, or to destroy his teachings. They will even go so far as to pretend, all right, to be or to imitate Christ or Christianity in order to deceive God's elect. They will. They'll go to any lengths to do that. And if we're not continually being taught the truths of God's word and how to walk in that truth, we'll be easily deceived by them as well. Now, some of these deceivers and liars are easily recognizable, right? I mean, we could go through a list of names. I'm not going to mention them. But, I mean, we know some of these people who are totally anti-Christ. Right? We know them by name. They're not afraid to announce it. They'll tell her, Ted Turner, he's one of them. Okay, I'm not even sure he's still alive, but he's one of them, or was one of them. Stephen Hawking, whatever his name was, he died. He was one of them. All right? So, I mean, there's. I said I wasn't going to list names, and here I am listing names, right? That's just the way it works. But look, there are some who are easily recognizable. They're not ashamed of it. They don't care. Right? They're very outspoken against Christianity, and their actions clearly prove that they're against Christ. Then there are some who are not so easily recognizable. These were particularly true in John's day when many Jews who were opposed to Christianity, they didn't accept Jesus as their Messiah, they would infiltrate the church posing as Christians and teaching false doctrines. Why? Because there was many Jews in the church back then. And so they thought they could infiltrate the church. They would go in there and imitate Christ or pretend to be a Christian, start teaching false doctrines like, well, you got to be circumcised. Well, you got to do this. You got to do that. You got to keep the law. That's exactly what they would do. All right? These were the wolves in sheep's clothing that Jesus spoke about. And there are still some of those in the church today with ulterior motives. They really are out there. But there are also many Christians today who have been taught the truth of God's word and yet who choose to live contrary to the truth. They make an intentional decision to choose to live or walk contrary to what they've been taught. They too, listen to me very carefully and I'll explain it. They too are deceivers and liars. They are. They may very well be saved and on their way to heaven, but they're living a lie. And they are just as anti-Christian as the obvious opponents of Christ. They claim to love Jesus, and yet they don't keep his commandments or even try. They go to church, they pray, and even read their Bibles from time to time, but their living is opposed. Their living is opposite. Their living is an opponent of the truth of God's word. And here's the worst part. Okay? They cause other children of God to do the same. Again, our actions speak louder than our instructions. They lead their own physical children to walk or live in opposition to the truth. And they'll also cause younger and immature spiritual Christians, maybe some who are brand new Christians and don't know, and they'll be watching their life thinking, oh, this person's been a Christian for a long time. I'll watch how they live and I'll live as they live. But they're living a lie. They're deceivers and liars. They live in opposition to the truth. Now, maybe not intentionally, but you know what? The result is still the same. The result is still the same. John wrote back in 1 John chapter 2, verse 22. You remember this. I'll put it up here. Who is a liar but he that denieth that Jesus is the Christ? He is Antichrist that denieth the Father and the Son. Something very interesting that I want to point out here. Though the Greek word for denieth, we know, generally means to disavow or reject the truth. It could mean that here. It can also mean to contradict. The word denieth there could mean to contradict that Jesus is the Christ. A child of God, get this, contradicts the truthful teaching that Jesus is the Christ when they don't walk or live by that truthful teaching. Does that make sense? It's a contradiction. They're basically denying that Jesus is the Christ. They're contradicting it with their walk. That's just the way it works. Our living contradicts our speech. Our walk contradicts our talk, right? Now, we'll talk about verse number 8 in a moment, but notice what verse 9 says here. We'll come back to verse 8, but verse 9 goes along with what we were just talking about. He says, whosoever transgresseth and abideth not in the doctrine of Christ hath not God. He that abideth in the doctrine of Christ, he hath both the Father and the Son. John is basically telling the elect lady here how to recognize these antichrists or these deceivers and liars. And the first thing he talks about is that they don't abide in the truth. They abide not in the truth. That's one of the ways you can tell, right? Christians ought to pay very close attention to this word abideth. When you see it in God's word, you ought to pay very close attention to it. It's very important, just like we saw back in 1 John. It means to stay in, to remain in, or to continue to live in whatever it is it's talking about. And just as he did in 1 John, John says here that faithful believers will abide or continue to live in Christ. Now, I know he says here the doctrines of Christ. The Greek word for doctrine simply means instructions or teachings of Christ. But that's what they'll do. They'll continually abide in the teachings of Christ. They'll live in them. They'll be in them daily. They'll study them. They'll read upon them. They'll meditate upon them. The doctrines or the teachings of Christ. That's what it means to abide in the doctrines. Deceivers and liars, which I remind you can include Christians, do not abide or live in that truth. They're not living according to the teachings or the doctrines of Christ. And look, usually before we had to go all this other stuff in live and everything else, I'd open it up and say, give me some examples of this. But I'll just give them to you. For instance, they don't love their enemies or the brethren like Jesus taught them to do. They don't abide in the truths of or in the doctrines of Christ. They exact vengeance upon others. When somebody does something to them, they retaliate and turn around and do something back to them instead of overcoming their evil by doing that person good like Jesus taught and like Paul taught in Romans 12. They badmouth other people. Is that ever taught in Scripture? No. Matter of fact, our speech is supposed to be edifying, right? No matter who it is. The only praying they do for others that they don't like is for them to get run over by a truck or something. That was supposed to be funny. Wasn't funny. There's a song like that that Jana Wilson gave me years ago. She said something called Pray, a country song called Pray. Prayed that her brakes went out or something rolling down the hill in his truck. I don't know. Anyway, that's sometimes the only praying some Christians will do. And depending on who they're around, they don't mind compromising their faith by being involved in things they know that Jesus would be displeased with and wouldn't approve of. These are those who are not abiding in the doctrines of Christ or in the teachings of Christ. John also says here in verse 9 that another way to recognize these deceivers and liars is that they abide in their sin or their transgressions. This isn't speaking of someone who either unintentionally commits a sin or a transgression against God. This is speaking about someone who intentionally and continually abides in or lives in that sin. You see the difference? There's a difference in committing a sin and continually committing a sin over and over and over and over again. It's not because they cannot overcome it. Deceivers and liars either don't feel like they have to overcome it or they don't want to overcome it. They are intentionally living a lie. If they truly wanted to overcome it, they would seek out ways to do so in Jesus' teachings or in the Word of God. Or maybe by somebody, a spiritual leader, who will point them to the Word of God on how to help them to overcome those situations. These are the ones John is warning the elect lady about. And they're not that difficult to recognize, even if they've infiltrated the church. Jesus said, you shall know them by what? Their fruits. That's right. We can tell by their living. If they're not continually living in and abiding in the truthful doctrines of Christ, Or if they're continually living in or abiding in their sin, then they're deceivers and liars according to the Word of God. Plain and simple. John says, keep doing what you've been doing, but in the meantime, watch out for anyone who might lead you away from the truth. Man, there's the Bible warns us all the time about defections from the truth. As a matter of fact, that's why I'm going to write my dissertation on apostasy and a defection or a getting away of the teaching of God's Word and getting away from the truth. It's all throughout God's Word, and there's warnings everywhere. Then he says in verse number 8, look to yourselves that we lose not those things which we have wrought or worked so hard for, but that we receive a full reward. And you know me, I like talking about rewards, right? Here we see John's warning of losing rewards. John warns them of deceivers and liars. He also warns them of losing rewards here. And when he says, look to yourselves, John is not saying, hey, look out for number one, right? The Word of God never says that. The Greek word for look here speaks of being on the lookout or to beware. He's still warning the elect lady here. The Greek word for wrought here speaks of what they had worked so hard for. And John says, keep doing what you've been doing and beware of deceivers and liars who want to throw you off track and keep you from receiving the full rewards that you've worked so hard for and that God wants you to have. That's what he says here in a nutshell. Proverbs 11:18 speaks to what John is talking about. Here's what it says. It says, the wicked worketh a deceitful work, deceivers and liars. But to him that soweth righteousness shall be a sure reward. Living in, sowing in the seeds of righteousness. Living according to the truth, walking in the truth. Now, John isn't just talking about here in our passage about just about the heavenly rewards that we're going to receive for our service to the Lord. For God also openly rewards us on the earth for our faithful service to him. How many of you have been serving God know that God has rewarded you on this earth? Yeah. And if you don't know it, let me just share with you. He has. Amen. Everything you got. Everything that you're blessed with. You say, well, I got 5 kids. That's a blessing. 2 more and you got your quiver full. No. You can adopt a couple, it'd be all right. I'm just kidding. Okay? Everything we have is a blessing from God. Do you know that even you having the ability to go to work tomorrow morning is a gift from God? Did you know that just having the brain to be able to cipher 2 + 2 gives you the ability to do some of the things you do at work? We take that for granted all the time. You know, there's a lot of people who unfortunately have to live in a wheelchair. That's still a blessing because they're still alive. But you know what? We're blessed that maybe we're not in that wheelchair or that we don't have this disability or that disability. Listen, everything we have, God has blessed us with, and we ought to be thankful for it. He openly rewards us. But do you remember a moment ago when we were talking about those who didn't live according to the doctrines of Christ and how instead of returning good for evil, they returned evil for evil? They retaliated? Here's what Proverbs 25 says, verses 21 and 22. Now, I've quoted this before. Whoop, I don't know how that went backwards. Get back here. I don't know. I'm way off here somewhere. There we go. It says, if thine enemy be hungry, give him bread to eat. If he be thirsty, give him water to drink. For thou shalt heap coals of fire upon his head. Watch this. And the Lord shall reward thee. He said, man, I'm not going to do anything good for my enemy. You don't know what he's done to me. Hey, you got a reward coming if you will. There's a reward coming for you doing that good even when somebody does you evil. Right there it says it. The Lord himself is going to reward you just for being obedient to him. You see, most people out here, they don't know that principle. The world doesn't know that principle. We do. God's going to reward us just for doing what he says. Turn over to Matthew chapter 6. Turn over to Matthew chapter number 6. Jesus mentioned a few of these earthly rewards when he was giving his Sermon on the Mount. I had you turn there because I want to do a little bit of reading here. Notice verse 1, he says, "Take heed that you do not your alms or your good deeds," or whatever you want to call that, "before men to be seen of them. Otherwise," because if you do, "you have no reward of your Father which is in heaven." Okay? You want to do a good deed for somebody? Great. Do it for God. Don't do it for yourself. If you do it for yourself, you have no reward coming from God. If you do it to be seen of men, to be popular, to be, oh man, to get that pat on the back, yeah, guess what? You're going to get your reward, but you're getting nothing from God. Understand? Great, let's move on. "Therefore, when thou doest thine alms, do not sound a trumpet or toot your own horn before thee, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, that they may have glory of men." Somebody might praise God for them. "Verily I say unto you, they have their reward." They got their reward right there. "When thou doest thine alms, let not thy left hand know what thy right hand doeth." We was talking about this last night in class. I actually have a Sermon on the Mount class, and we was talking about this last night. This ought to be, we ought to be doing almsgiving all the time for so many people that we don't even know we're doing it. This is a lifestyle that Jesus is talking about in Matthew 5 through 7. This is how we ought to be living as Christians. We ought to be doing this so often that we don't even know that we just did somebody some good. Watch what he says in verse 4, "that thine alms may be in secret, and thy Father which seeth in secret shall reward thee openly." You want real glory? Let it come from God and not man. Change your life. Verse 5, "when thou prayest, let us not be as the hypocrites are, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues in the corner of the streets. They may be seen of men." Again, it's all about the external. It's not about the internal for them people. "Verily I say unto you, they have their reward." They got it. You want the pat on the back? You got it. "But thou, when thou prayest, enter into thy closet. When thou shut the door, pray to the Father which is in secret. And thy Father which seeth in secret shall reward thee openly." Drop down to verse 16. "Moreover, when you fast, be not as the hypocrites, of a sad countenance." They disfigure their faces that they may appear unto men to fast. They want everybody to know that they're super spiritual and they're fasting today. "Verily I say unto you, they have their reward." Oh, look at brother so-and-so over there. Man, he's such a spiritual man. He fasts once a week. He does this and not, yada, 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 yada. "Thou, when thou fastest," he says in verse 17, "anoint thine head and wash thy face, that thou appear not unto men to fast." Nobody even recognizes it. "But unto the Father which is in secret, and thy Father which seeth in secret shall reward thee openly." God's going to reward you not only later in heaven, but also now for living the way he wants us to live. And then Jesus went on to say that heavenly rewards also awaited them for those who were doing these things or living according to his teachings. Verse 19, "lay not up for yourselves treasures up on the earth where moth and rust doth corrupt," right? "And where thieves break through and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust doth corrupt, neither do thieves where thieves do not break through and steal. For there, where your treasure is, there will your heart be also." Those abiding in or living in the doctrines or the teachings of Jesus Christ will receive the full rewards that God has for them. Earthly rewards and heavenly rewards. But there's also the possibility of losing rewards. You know, you might do them for the right reason at the start, and then later on, start tooting your horn about what you did. Guess what? You just lost your reward because you just got it from man instead of waiting on it from God. Jesus even says here in Matthew 6 that loss of rewards from him occur when, like the deceivers and liars, we live for the rewards of man. You have your reward. Yes, we'll receive the pat on the back that we worked so hard to get, but guess what? We get nothing. We get nothing from God. We lose the greater rewards that God wanted us to give us, both eternally and earthly, for doing those things for Him instead of ourselves. I think we're all guilty of, you know, liking to be praised and liking to receive glory from things. But look, we already got the reward for that. Nothing's coming from God for those things. Deceivers and liars teach believers to live for themselves. That's what they're living for. They're not living the doctrines of Christ. And yes, the pat on the back once in a while feels pretty good. But that's the only reward we receive. We lost the reward of God. And listen, when we do get to heaven and we're standing before the judgment seat of Christ to receive our eternal rewards, the Bible clearly teaches that we're going to get for all of our works that we did for God. Guess what? Everything we thought or believed that we did for God, all those works are going to be cast into a fire. The Bible very clearly teaches that they're going to go through the fire. And after going through the fire, here's what Paul writes in 1 Corinthians chapter 3. If any man's work abide or remains, which he hath built thereupon, he shall receive a reward. It's not going to be an earthly reward. It's not going to be some reward from some man, a pat on the back. This is going to be an eternal reward. If any man's work shall be burned, in other words, he did it for himself. He already got the reward on the earth. He shall suffer loss of that reward, but he himself shall be saved, yet so as by fire. If we're doing the Lord's work for the Lord and not for ourselves, we will be rewarded for it. If we do the Lord's work for ourselves, then we've already been rewarded for it by man, and there is no reward coming from God. John doesn't want the elect lady here to miss out on any rewards that God has for her. Whether this is speaking of a specific lady or the church, he wants them to keep doing what they've been doing. He's actually praising them here as he's warning them. He wants them to keep doing what they've been doing for all the right reasons with all the right motivations, so they could continue to make a difference for the kingdom of God, and so they'll receive the full rewards that God has for them to receive. And you know, God's got a whole bunch of them. I have no idea what they all are. I don't think the Bible teaches us about all the rewards that we're going to get. All I know is he's going to reward us, and we know how good God is at rewarding. Look at you. Your life is blessed. All right? That's just the earthly blessing. Can you imagine what the eternal and the heavenly ones are going to be? Where moth the rust doesn't corrupt, where thieves cannot break through and steal. Man, it's eternal. It's going to last you forever. All right? And that only comes when we continue to abide in and walk in the truth. But when you just sit there and learn the truth and you still walk opposite from it or opposing of it, then you're basically just deceiving and lying to yourself. It's not really doing you any good unless you're applying what you learn and growing from it. And that's the whole point so far of this message and John's message here to this elect lady. Let's stand.